undertaking a review in contemplation of agreeing on an extended mandate. This plenary is timely and is of particular significance to us in the region. Some of you may recall that in the year 2001, in the heyday of the harmful tax competition initiative, Barbados hosted the joint OECD Commonwealth high-level consultation on harmful tax competition. That was a multilateral dialogue on harmful tax competition, which sowed the seeds for what is now a more inclusive global forum, the Global Forum on Transparency and Exchange of Information for Tax Purposes. 14 years later, we are here again in Barbados at another critical juncture to review the progress and shape the future of the Global Forum and the global tax agenda. For many of us, this plenary could not come at a better time, since the issues that you will be considering over the next 2 days were coincidentally also important issues for consideration in the early days of the harmful tax competition initiative. I take this opportunity, of course, to commend the Honorable Don Valinis, Minister of International Business, for his leadership in these matters, both in Barbados and as a vice chair of the steering group of the Global Forum, and also to thank his officers at the ministry and stakeholders generally for helping us reach this far in our relationship with the Global Forum. As you are aware, Minister Innes has a long history of work in the international business and financial services sector. And as I understand it, it was his initiative that made this special occasion a reality for Barbados and the Caribbean. I take this opportunity also to laud the Global Forum for the strides made over the years. There is no disputing the significant progress the Forum has made since it was first established in the year 2009. As the Global Forum on Tax Transparency and Exchange of Information for Tax Purposes approaches its 6th year of existence, you can reflect on the fact that the Forum has emerged to be a leading voice in international tax cooperation. The organization brings together some 127 countries to cooperate on transparency and exchange of information matters, and has undertaken peer reviews of 120 jurisdictions and provided training and technical support to many members. Much work and effort has gone into bringing us this far, and so this forum must not let anything undermine what it has already accomplished or impede the work that we are committed to achieving together in the medium and the long term. There are, however, some issues that I believe must be addressed at this juncture if the progress of developing countries, particularly small developing countries, is to be sustained. In that connection, I believe that the words of the former US President Franklin D. Roosevelt are apt. I quote him, "The test of our progress is not whether we add more to the abundance of those who have much. It is whether we provide enough for those who have too little," unquote. To give flesh to that quotation, I must share with you the origins of a small financial center like Barbados. Barbados is a country whose society and economy were based on the sugar plantation model imposed by a colonial system. Through the years, as the colonial power changed the arrangements for the export of sugar, which eventually operated under the European Economic Community, now the European Union, we had to seek other alternatives for our economy based on our special assets. These assets were good governance and transparency, respect for the rule of law and a good legal system, an excellent quality of education and a highly educated population, good communications and other infrastructure, a good social system, and overall, a high quality of life as assessed by the United Nations Development Program. These supported the infrastructure needed to establish Barbados as an international financial services center. We have nurtured the reputation of the services we provide jealously and spare no effort in doing all that we can to enable our jurisdiction to withstand the closest inspection. In the past, we had a comparative advantage in sugar, but that was slowly whittled away with competition. Now we have a competitive advantage in the area of financial services, for which we have worked very hard over the years. We do not wish to feel that each time that we develop a competitive advantage, the playing field rules will change and place us on a path of continually having to seek new and legitimate ways of providing for our people. Barbados, like other small financial centers in the Caribbean and elsewhere, is doing all within its power to comply with internationally agreed standards. We've been working assiduously to implement the recommendations coming out of our phase two peer review, while at the same time readying ourselves for both the Foreign Accounts Tax Compliance Act, FATCA, and the Automatic Exchange of Information as an early adopter. In that regard, please permit me to update you on our progress. We are pleased to announce that Barbados will be signing both the Multilateral Convention on Mutual Administrative Assistance in Tax Matters and the Multilateral Competent Authority Agreement during this plenary. Actually, the Multilateral Convention was signed yesterday, and the Competent Authority Agreement will be signed later today. Shortly thereafter, we will be requesting a supplemental report as we have taken action that we believe should lead to an upgrade of our overall country rating from partially compliant to largely compliant. Barbados is also at an advanced stage in implementing the standard on automatic exchange of information as an early adopter. Our Parliament has recently passed legislation to give effect to the USA Foreign Accounts Tax Compliance Act, paving the way for Barbados to automatically exchange tax information with the United States of America. We express sincerest thanks to the Global Forum Secretariat and the OECD for their support during this process aimed at reaching the highest international standard of automatic exchange of information. Let me assure all present that Barbados, like the other countries here today, remains fully committed to and actively engaged in the work of the Global Forum. Yet, despite the high level of compliance and cooperation as reflected in the forum, and despite the plethora of exchange of information agreements signed and implemented, as the Global Forum and the OECD will testify, some of us are constantly placed on the defensive. We've had to fight to defend our legitimacy and existence as international financial centers, a developmental option which is inextricably linked to our country's developmental goals and the well-being of our people. We are particularly concerned that even at this stage, when the forum is considering its third mandate, there are still some member countries, even members of this forum, that create blacklists of other countries without regard to the implications such actions could have. These events take us back to the pre-2009 period and the earlier times that led to our hosting here in Barbados the high-level consultation on harmful tax competition. I am mindful that it may be quite easy for some to forget the consistent and determined struggle of small financial centers like those in the Caribbean to have a voice and a say on matters of international tax cooperation. I believe that it is important for those present to reflect on the progress the forum has made over the years, which has allowed for proper and respectful dialogue between interested parties. Let us not forget our history and repeat the mistakes of the past. I am mindful of the words of the first President of the United States of America, George Washington, that we should not look back unless it is to derive useful lessons from past errors and for the purpose of profiting by dearly bought experience. The recent publishing of a list by the European Union deeming 30 countries, including Barbados and others in the region, as non-cooperative and tax havens, once again highlights the concerns of the region regarding blacklisting by international organizations. This type of action can have a devastating impact on the reputation of our countries. It increases our risk profiles and affects our ability to retain or attract new investment, and also has the potential to jeopardize the ease with which investors can access funding. Now, as the current chairman of the CARICOM community, I should like to register our deep disappointment at the conduct of those in the European Union with whom we have had several fora for dialogue in this matter. Barbados and other Caribbean countries are therefore most grateful to both the director of the Center for Tax Policy and Administration with the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, Mr. Pascal Saint-Amand, and the head of the Secretariat of the Global Forum on Transparency and Exchange of Information for Tax Purposes, Ms. Monica Bhatia, for making it clear that, and I quote, as the OECD and the Global Forum, we would like to confirm that the only agreeable assessment of countries as regards their cooperation is made by the Global Forum, that a number of the countries identified in the EU exercise are either fully or largely compliant and have committed to the automatic exchange of information, sometimes even as early adopters. Without prejudice to countries' sovereign positions, we are happy to confirm that these jurisdictions are cooperative, and we would like to commend the tremendous progress made over the past years, as well as the cooperation and integrity of the Global Forum process, unquote. That intervention by the OECD and Global Forum has mitigated the impact of the damage to the reputation of our countries caused by that blacklist. Some countries have since contacted us, however, to clarify their positions, and we appreciate that initiative as well. If there's anything positive to be taken away from that unfortunate situation, it is that it brought into sharp focus the existence of blacklists, of which many of us were not aware. It brought into focus also the inconsistencies in the methods used to create and apply those blacklists. Having settled our position in relation to the European Union's lists, we soon had to contend with another one, this time not from a country, but from the District of Columbia in the United States of America. This occurred despite Barbados's having in place a double taxation agreement, a tax information exchange agreement, and an intergovernmental agreement to implement FATCA and exchange tax information automatically with the United States of America. Again, In order to minimize any fallout, we've had to divert our already limited resources from use for developmental purposes to deal with this unnecessary new distraction. I strongly believe, ladies and gentlemen, that the blacklisting of member countries of the forum by other members of the forum should have no place in the life and operations of this great organization. This appears to be in direct contradiction to the express purpose for which the forum exists. It is my view that the forum should not leave here this week without having come to a clear position on the way forward on this important issue. I believe that with a concerted effort, we can address this matter appropriately. There's an equally worrisome issue in the resolution of which I suggest that the Global Forum has an important role to play. This relates to the purposes for which the Forum's work is used by some multinational financial organizations. We are aware that some multinational financial organizations have implemented policies that use the Forum's ratings in a manner that, in effect, has the unintended consequence of penalizing countries that are rated partially compliant or lower. Barbados' experience has been that despite being fully engaged in the Global Forum's process and showing a real commitment to implementing the necessary recommendations, we were in danger of losing one of our major companies. In effect, a Barbados entity was having difficulty accessing financing from a multimillion dollar project because we had not yet completed implementing a recommendation that could trigger a request to the Global Forum for a supplemental report within certain time frames set by the financial institution. In this case, the key issue we had to address in order to have an overall rating of at least largely compliant was a non-technical matter which had to do with our policy preference to negotiate tax treaties rather than tax information exchange. For us, tax treaties, in addition to providing for exchange of information in line with the standard, also facilitate trade and investment between countries. The forum had deemed that we needed to respond to requests for tax information exchange agreements. We are well past that stage now, as we have signed on to the multilateral convention, as I indicated earlier. Unless such financial institutions communicate with both the Global Forum and the affected countries, they run the risk of making decisions without fully appreciating the peculiarities of the country and the progress it is making to address the concerns. This is even more so in cases where the Global Forum itself acknowledges the progress that the country concerned is making and is working with that country to help it to implement the recommendations. Under such circumstances, therefore, a country's development goals can be compromised because of the weight given to a policy which seems not to fully take into consideration that country's interaction with the Global Forum processes. I am of the view that there needs to be some mechanism to ensure that countries which have fully committed to the Global Forum's process and are actively taking the steps to implement recommendations to its satisfaction do not suffer the fate of being penalized by other agencies. I believe that the Global Forum has a very important role in contributing to this discussion. In relation to double taxation agreements, I should like also to urge the Global Forum to encourage its members, particularly the developed countries, to take action to ratify negotiated and agreed tax treaties. It appears that in the effort to quickly implement the standard on transparency and exchange of information, double taxation agreements have not been given their deserved priority. This leads us to a very important question that this eighth plenary of the Global Forum may want to consider in its deliberations. What role should the Global Forum play in addressing the wide range of tax and tax-related issues highlighted in the concerns of small, vulnerable countries? I believe that you are well aware of ongoing discussions on the role of the United Nations and the role it can play in these matters of international tax cooperation. The comments made in April 2011 by Her Excellency Mrs. Paulette Bethel on behalf of CARICOM on the report of the Secretary General on strengthening of institutional arrangements to promote international cooperation in tax matters remains relevant at this time and in our present circumstances. I quote, "It is the view of CARICOM countries that tax cooperation is an important aspect of the modern global economy, and while we recognize the efforts of existing bodies to coordinate international tax transparency matters, there still remains a need to establish a forum with universal membership embodying truly democratic principles and a level playing field, or as the Secretary General's report so succinctly puts it, a forum that would offer developing countries a full seat at the table. We subscribe to the principle that an effective response to a global crisis requires inclusive and comprehensive global action that allows for the participation of all concerned stakeholders," unquote. Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I should like to encourage you to have frank discussions over these next 2 days. May I suggest that you reflect deeply on the genesis of the forum, its objectives, its achievements, and any obstacles to future development with a view to addressing any issues that could undermine the progress made by this global forum so far. Being accountable to the people of Barbados, a small island developing country, and to the CARICOM community in my capacity as current chairman, it would be remiss of me not to leave you with a challenge. The challenge to be mindful of the far-reaching implications of your decisions and their likely effects, not just on a country or a region in the abstract, but on the lives of the actual people inhabiting the island nations of our highly prized Caribbean civilization. Thank you very much.
Honourable Prime Minister Stuart, Honourable Minister Donwell Innes, ministers from other jurisdictions and ambassadors, dignitaries and colleagues, I would like to welcome you to the 8th meeting of our Global Forum here in Barbados. But allow me first of all to kick off by thanking the Prime Minister for opening our proceedings this morning. And thank you, Prime Minister. We've said this to your to Minister Innes, I mean, over and over over the past few days. But thank you very much to you and your government for hosting our plenary meeting and some of our other meetings here during this week in Barbados. I don't think we could have wished for a more beautiful place to have our discussions. I think at times we're going to struggle to really keep the interest and focus and attention of the people inside the room while they're all thinking about all the beautiful things that they can see outside. But we will try our best to keep them interested. Thank you also, Prime Minister, for your kind words, recognizing the important work of the Global Forum, and recognizing the progress that we have made over the last number of years. You've correctly reflected a little bit on the past, what happened during the early 2000s and how we had a huge change in focus in 2009. And since then, I think we've made some huge progress collectively as an institution. You've also mentioned and raised a number of interesting points. I'm sure we're going to pick up on some of those issues during our discussions and reflect on them and discuss them during our proceedings. The Caribbean is a very important region for us. The Global Forum has, as you know, met in many, many places of the world before, but we've decided this year, after the offers that we've had, that we would meet in Barbados. And I think some of the reasons why we have chosen Barbados is to build and to strengthen our ties with the Caribbean and to form a partnership with the Caribbean and to recognize the important work that the Caribbean countries have done over the last number of years and the progress that they have made in the field of tax transparency. I think as an organization, I can safely say that we have gone from strength to strength over the last number of years. Since our last meeting in Berlin in October last year, another 6 member countries have joined us. And I'd like to use this opportunity to welcome Armenia, Bulgaria, Cote d'Ivoire, Niger, Papua New Guinea, and Tanzania as our latest new members. With these 6 members, we've taken the membership of the Global Forum now to 129 members. I understand there is another application in the pipeline. So it might be that even before the end of this year, we might break the 130 ceiling. I think this is the number of countries that have joined the Global Forum is really and truly reflective of the open organization that we represent. I think we can truly say that we are a global organization now. We are a very diverse organization. We have members, whether they are big or small, OECD, non-OECD, developed, non-developed. We try to be as inclusive as possible. And with an outcome that, as you've mentioned during your speech, that everybody has a voice around the table. And that we can talk, and from a tax transparency point of view, make sure that we're leveling the playing field for everybody. I've been informed by the Secretariat that we have 230 delegates that have joined us here, or will join us here over the next 2 days from 88 countries. There's also 10 international organizations that are being represented here. So we have a very busy agenda ahead of us. and we're going to require, as the Prime Minister said, some discussions, some debates, some decisions. We need some guidance from you on a number of issues to shape the work of the Global Forum for 2016 and the years ahead. Some of the issues that we will be touching on, of course, specifically is automatic exchange of information. And I'm sure you're going to hear that the big focus on automatic exchange of information is going to be implementation. You're going to hear this word implementation over and over the next few days. And that's the focus, and you're going to hear about tools that will be made available to assist the jurisdiction to implement. On exchange of information on request, our other pillar of our work, I think one of the outcomes that we would like to see from this forum is that the revised terms of reference is sanctioned by this body so that we can start planning the next round of reviews. We've put in a lot of hard work over the last 2 years to get to today and tomorrow and the next day, where we would hopefully like to get the blessing of this forum on the new terms of reference. Then, of course, assistance. Assistance is something that's very close to the heart of the Global Forum. we've got to look after our smaller jurisdictions. It's not always smaller jurisdictions, funny enough, that requires assistance. Sometimes even some of the larger jurisdictions require guidance and assistance. But this is an area that we feel very passionate about. And that we're going to make sure that we don't leave anybody behind as far as our objectives are concerned. So it's difficult to predict what is going to happen in the future. Just as we could not, perhaps in 2009, when we restructured the Global Forum, I think very few people could have imagined where we would be today in 2015 and the progress that we have made so far. And the same if after the next 5 years of our new term, I think in 2020, if we look back, who knows what new challenges might face us in 2020. But one thing that I do know, and I think that I would like to emphasize, is that there's a massive amount of work that's lying ahead for us in the Global Forum. I don't think we always realize the enormity of the tasks that are lying ahead of us just on the automatic exchange of information alone. It's a game-changing exercise. It will change the world as far as transparency is concerned. Just imagine when 80, 90, 100, or even more than 100 countries are starting to exchange information, what the impact of that will be. But one thing that I've noticed, especially over the year and even in some of the meetings that we've had earlier during this week, if you listen to the discussions and the debates of the people, when the people talk, you hear, I think, the passion and the excitement with which they speak. And they are up for the challenge, and they're ready for the challenges, whether it's new delegates that have joined us recently, whether it's some of our more experienced delegates that have been with us for a while, whether it's younger people, and I see a lot of young people around the table, new people have joined us. Everybody feels very passionate about the work of the Global Forum. So that gives me great comfort, and I think the Global Forum, I think, is in good hands. And we look forward to the challenges that are lying ahead, and I think that's the spirit that we would like to see prevailing in our discussions, that we have our debates in a very constructive, objective, transparent, and a professional way. So colleagues, thank you in advance, and we look forward to some lively debates, some really constructive debates, and some fruitful outcomes after the next 2 days. And Prime Minister, once again, thank you very much for honoring us with your presence here today. Thank you very much. We will break now. There's a photo that's going to be taken outside. So we will break now, and then after the photo shoot, we will come back.